In this video, I'll give a quick introduction to some of the algorithms that you can use to estimate directed acyclic graphs. Mainly, if you try to estimate a DAG, you should not expect that you can fully estimate one particular DAG. And that is because you have these equivalent models, right? So A causes B is equivalent to A is caused by B. So usually at best, what these algorithms try to do is estimate a equivalence class, which means a set of models that have the same or equivalent fit. And that's really one way you should look at it. So often when you run these models, you get, for example, an undirected edge, which is then actually used to indicate we don't know the effect here. Or you bootstrap these results and you use the bootstraps to see how often you get a certain effect, and you get something like this, like, okay, I don't know if it's this arrow or this arrow because they're equivalent. There are two main types of algorithms that are used. There are more, but these are the two main ways to classify them. You have constraint-based algorithms and you have score-based algorithms. And the main difference between these is that constraint-based algorithms, they really look at the node-to-node level. So they usually look really closely at the DAG and look at every individual relationship and tries to orient these then as well. I'll show this later. Where the score-based algorithm, usually you could look at the entire picture altogether. So these do not zoom in on particular parts of the model, but rather they look if the entire model fits well or not. In both cases, you can use prior knowledge to help the algorithm a lot. And this can be done by whitelisting certain effects, which means that you allow an effect to be in there, or rather you force an effect to be in there, or blacklisting an effect of which you know that it cannot be in there. And this will eliminate a lot of potential models in the equivalent class. Now, a very important aspect on DAG estimation is that you realize which assumptions underlie these routines so that they work. And these are crucial. If these assumptions are violated, you're going to get something like nodes pointing to other nodes, but then that model is just simply wrong. So that's very important to know. And it's also very important to understand when you are considering estimating a DAG or not. The first assumption is the causal sufficiency assumption. So you could write this down as there exist no common unobserved variables in a domain that are parent of one or more observed variables in the domain. So the short way to say that is there are no latent variables. Right? So if I have variable A, and I have variable B, and let's have a latent variable, let's call that L. Right? Then if actually L causes A and B, that means that A and B are correlated. And they can only be independent after conditioning on L. But if we do not observe L, we cannot condition on L. So then if we only put A and B in the model, we would get something like A leads to B, or A is caused by B, but this would be wrong because that correlation is simply explained by L. That's very important. Now we get the same thing in the undirected models. Right? In the undirected models, we get an edge there. But it's less bad, I would say, because this doesn't have this very strong causal hypothesis with an arrow there. Right? And so if you see like an edge, you think, yeah, okay, that's a latent variable. In a DAG, that is kind of hard to see because you have this arrow. Right? So it's, one thing points to another one, and it immediately gives you a very strong causal idea there. The second assumption is the Markov assumption. Given that a Bayesian network, by the way, is just another way of saying directed acyclic graph. So sometimes you'll read Bayesian network, and it's just, it doesn't mean Bayesian analysis actually. It has nothing to do with Bayesian statistics. It has more to do with the idea that A causes B and B causes C means that A can be used to update B and B can be used to update C. So this is another way of saying DAG. Okay, so given a Bayesian network or DAG, model B, any variable is independent of all its non-descendants in B given its parents. That is very simply a way, or not simply, that is a way of saying that you assume asymmetrically, which means that you have no arrows going back. So this node is not a parent of its parents, right? So we don't have weird time traveling things in there. Then the last assumption is the faithfulness assumption. And that one is actually a little bit harder to understand. That basically means that the results or your conditional independencies that you obtain are due in line with the graph model that you have. So that I would translate that as saying just simply no weird stuff. To give an example, you can think of models in which you just happen to get numerically near zero conditional dependencies that are not actually due to the graph. For example, we have A causes B and C causes B, and let's say these effects are positive. And let's say I also have a direct effect here that is also positive, but is very weakly positive. Then conditioning on B will make A and C, it will induce a correlation between A and C that is a bit more negative. So it could be that this correlation here is pulled towards zero and just happens to be near zero after we condition on B, simply due to the way we parameterize this model. Then the modeling technique could see, oh, hey, I had a effect here, but it became zero after listening on B. And then you might get something weird, like a chain here where the XD collide. And there are other weird things that you can think of where the parameters just happen to cancel out or happen to add up in a way that you don't expect that something is near zero. And yeah, so basically it means no weird stuff. It basically means that you should not have this kind of stuff. In principle, it shouldn't be exactly possible because these are real numbers. You don't get exactly zeros. But if you then do statistics, you might like do an erroneous test here and say, okay, there's a independence here where it's actually not. Okay. So first I'll talk about score-based algorithms. So score-based algorithms rely on the entire DAG. So basically what they do is they fit the whole DAG, see if it fits, make a change, see if it fits better. Keep doing that until you get a best model. So these models fit several DAGs to some criterion and then select the best. And this could be like the AIC or the BIC, but it could also be like cross-validation prediction error or things like that. Some search strategies usually also need it. So you usually cannot test all DAGs, but if you have 10 variables, then there are a lot of possible DAGs that are possible, right, with arrows there or not. So you need some search strategy like adding or removing effects until it fits best. Very similar to some of the search strategies we use in undirected network models, like the GGM mod select algorithm. And this is used in psychological networks, for example, in this paper by Richard McNally and his colleagues. Richard McNally and his colleagues actually use this algorithm called hill climbing. And this is a very powerful, fast technique that basically what it does is you start with an empty network or a full network or a random network, just a starting point. And then you just keep adding or removing edges. So let's say we're going to try to add the edge AB, right? So this one here. Or we're going to try to delete AC. So then this one is gone, right? Or we're going to try to reverse AC. So then this one is now no longer A to B, C, but C to A. All right, we're going to just try all the things we can do. Then we're going to see, okay, we have some score. It might be like a BIC or an AIC or something else, right? And then we could see here that in this case, let's say this one is best, right? If higher is better. Or if it's BIC, lower is better, then this one would be best, right? So then we select that and then we keep doing that. And we just keep doing that iteratively until we have a best fitting model. And that's very powerful. But it doesn't mean that you don't actually look at every individual edge per se. It could be that you never really investigated this relationship in detail itself. You look more at the whole model and how it performs. So that's very powerful to do, but then you do want to do also bootstrapping methods after to see if you keep arising at the same solution or not. So this results in a local optimum. That means that depending on where you start, you get a network. And there is not really much control for overfitting. So that's why the bootstrapping is very important. Right? So you don't want to present only one, I would say. You want to also present like a range of possible networks. I think it's also important for the other algorithms as well, but especially for the score-based algorithms, that's important. Then the other class of models is more advanced. And these are called constraint-based algorithms. And what you do in constraint-based algorithms is not look at the whole picture, but rather look at every possible combination of variables and every possible edge. So you're going to look much more in detail in the network itself and build a picture up by doing a lot of small tests, small hypothesis-driven tests, like small tests, is this a correlation or not? Is this a partial correlation or not? That means that it's very powerful. You get a lot of insight really at detailed levels, and it is a bit better in giving you a cause interpretation because you know you really check all these condition dependence relationships. But at lower sample sizes, you also are more prone to errors because you might just have not enough power or you might have other problems with your data. So there are different algorithms you can use, and mainly they are based on this bit older inductive causation algorithm. Many of the other algorithms are just ways to speed up this inductive causation algorithm, which is a bit slow, but it's very insightful and relatively easy to understand. So the inductive causation algorithm takes these three steps. I'll show this in much more detail in the next slides. Basically, first, for every pair of variables, you look, is there a variable or an empty set on which you can condition to make them independent? If there is nothing that we condition on to make them independent, then we know, okay, so A and B have some link. We don't know what link, but they have some link because we really tried to make them independent, but we couldn't. Then for each triplet of nodes, each pair of three nodes that are connected in that way, we're going to check if B happens to be a middle node. All right, so we know if we see this and we don't see an S between A and C, we know that there was something we could condition on that made A and C independent. Then we just simply ask the question, was that B? And if that wasn't B, then that means B is not separating A and C. So then we can actually draw a collider on B, right? Because then we know that B was not separating A and C. There could be that A and C were just independent already given the empty set. Now, there are several examples of this. The main one I think is used in the literature is the PC algorithm, which is a very strong algorithm, just a fast version of the IC algorithm. So this is used, for example, in this classical paper by Danny Borsbaum and Hans-Dirk Kramer on network analysis, but also in a few more recent papers. And I'll have a video about an example as well at the end of the series. So let's look at an example of how this works. So let's say that this is our true network. Right, so we have several things here. We have like essence of class, motivation, grade, extracurricular activities, and diploma. So this is just, we measure a lot of students. We measure them on several things, and we assume that this is the underlying model. Let's say this is the underlying model. Right, we generate data, then we're going to try to recover this model from data that is generated by this model. So we don't know these edges. Right, we don't know them in reality. If you have a data set, we wouldn't know them. So we're going to try to uncover them. So then the first step of the IC algorithm is we're going to look for every pair of variables, and then we're going to ask the question, is there anything we can condition on to make these independent? Okay. So remember, essence of class and motivation were actually independent in the true network. So let's say we have a very good data set of this. Then we're going to look, okay, essence of class and motivation, do they correlate or are they independent? And we might try and get no, right? So we might get a non-significant p-value. We can even do a Bayesian test to get a Bayes factor. And even without conditioning on anything, we might already see that they are not correlated. So then we can already say, okay, there is something we can condition on, namely nothing. right? Or we can even condition on what we call the empty set. So there's some way to make these independent, so we don't draw any edge between them, and we move on. Okay, we go to easiness of class and grade. And then we're going to ask, are they correlated? Well, first we're going to check, are they correlated by themselves? We just do like core easiness of class and grade in R or something like that. Or if they're binary, we do like a chi-square test, I guess, for that. And then we see, yes, they're correlated, right? So they might be dependent. Then we're going to try, okay, so they're correlated. Can we condition on motivation to make them uncorrelated? Like to have a partial correlation of near zero or a non-significant? No. Can we condition on extracurricular activities? No. Can we condition on them both? No. Can we condition on diploma? No. Can we condition on all three of them? No. So we tried everything. Then we can draw this edge between each of class and grade, because there's nothing we can do to make them independent. Then we move on, the grade and motivation. Is there anything we can condition on? Well, you can pause the video here and think about it, of course, for a bit. And the answer is there's nothing we can condition on to make them independent. So again, we draw an edge. So eventually we're left with this. And this is what we call the DAG skeleton. Is a DAG with the arrowheads removed, which is something that we can actually estimate usually. The DAG skeleton is not a Markov-Vander field or indirect network. Why? Well, that's because in the Markov-Vander field, you'd also get an edge here, because there was a collider effect there. We condition grade and it makes it dependent. And in the Markov-Vander field, we only look at conditioning on everything. So that's the difference. So now we want to try to orientate these edges. Okay. How are we going to do that? For each triplet, we're going to look at, is the middle node in this set the one that separated these two nodes? So in this case, we know easiness of class and diploma were, we could condition on something to make them independent. So was that great? Yes, that was great, right? So yes, so we don't do anything. Okay, we tried, yeah, we can't figure it out. Okay, we move on. Easiness of class, grade, motivation. Now we're going to think again and ask again, was grade the thing we conditioned on to make easiness of class and motivation independent? Now you can pause the video and then think about it. Okay, so is grade the middle node in the set of nodes or empty set that made easiness of class and motivation independent? And the answer is no. That's because they were already independent to begin with. So we did not need grade to make them independent. In fact, it made things worse. So then we can see, okay, well, that is interesting, because if grade is not in the set of the combination of variables that made them independent, then this structure can only occur if this is a collider. And that really is the whole idea behind these constraint-based algorithms, is we're going to search for colliders. That's the only thing that is really identified. Other things are not really identified, because these chains and common causes are not distinguishable, but colliders are. All right, so all these algorithms really rely on this. Okay, let's search for colliders. So now we have arrows, and now we can go back to other variables actually. So we now know this collider is there. Now we can ask the question, okay, do we now know the direction of the edge between grade and diploma? So do we know this direction now? Okay, and you can pause the video and think about it. So the answer is yes, we actually know this now. Because before we looked at these three and we said, no, grade is not a collider. We moved on. But now it has to be this edge, because otherwise it would be a collider. Right, so now we can orientate this as well. And that's useful, right? Extremely useful. Do we now also know the direction of the effect between motivation and IQ? This one here. Well, the answer is no. We actually don't, because it doesn't matter. It would not create a collider here. So it could be still either way. So that means that we cannot orientate it any further. And this is basically what we're left with. This is the equivalent set where we have these two models and we can't really distinguish between them anymore. And so that's the result of your model. And usually then you would represent it like this with an undirected edge. But you could also just show both, right? So then you have this final model where you have one edge where you couldn't distinguish between the cause and effect. Okay, so that's constraint-based and score-based algorithms. So the constraint-based algorithms, they are more specific and detailed, and they also allow for more certain cause interpretation. But if you have a low sample size, it could also be much more prone to like lower power and things like that, because you're doing a lot of tests. Like you're doing constantly like a lot of small significance tests. Where the score-based algorithm, that's just one test, one fit, one fit, one fit. And that's a very different way of looking at these things. So that's the difference between them. And it also really depends on, if you have a lot of data and you really want this fine-grained, more strong cause interpretation, then I would do the constraint-based algorithms. But otherwise, you can do these score-based algorithms as well. And they both work pretty well. There are also some hybrid methods, actually, that try to take the best from both worlds. And yeah, there's really not time here to go into detail in that. So for practicing with this, I would just pick one. But if you then want to write a paper on this, then you might want to delve a bit more deeper into the literature and see which one would actually be best for you. Okay, so when do you estimate a DAG and when do you estimate an undirected network? And so you now know two ways. If you did all the videos, you now know two ways of estimating network models. So why would you prefer one over the other? Now, I would say I prefer to estimate undirected network models in most cases, actually, because they don't rely on these very strong assumptions that the DAG has. Right? They don't rely on this acyclicity assumption, and they give a very interpretable picture. They don't even rely on the causal assumption. Many people make this mistake in the literature as well. They say that to estimate an undirected network model, you need to assume a DAG is underlying data. That is not true. Because you can also use the undirected network model to simply look at the predictive effects between your variables, see what predicts what. You could even use it to try to discover related variables by looking at the clustering. Right? And if the assumption underlying a DAG is violated, like there's a latent variable, it matters less for the undirected network because you don't have this very strong causal interpretation. But there are certainly cases in which you would like to estimate a DAG, I think, instead of an undirected network. Mainly, if you do assume that a DAG is underlying the network or the data, so if you really think in this data set, the underlying causal model is a DAG, and your target of inference is that you want to uncover this DAG, right, then use the DAG estimation tools. Right, then try to estimate a DAG, use the bootstrapping to see what kind of DAGs get out there. That is what you want to do then. If you have strong reasons to believe that there are no cyclic relationships, then you can use the DAGs as well because you're trying to uncover acyclicity. And mainly, if you have very strong prior expectations on some edges, like for example, you know that any edges too exogenous variables, like age, for example, or country where you live in, can be blacklisted, can be removed. Or you know already from theory that certain edges should be there. Right? So many causal effects we know. Right? And then you can whitelist them. Right? So that is actually very powerful for these DAG estimation tools. If you can aid the algorithm in this way, by whitelisting and blacklisting edges, then you can help the algorithm a lot. And it will give you a much more sensible result. And then also, if you already know that, okay, I have nodes in there, but I know that this cannot cause that, right? And this cannot cause that, then you might really want to do the DAGs instead of the undirected networks, because you already have a lot of information about this as well. So that's what I say would be reasons for to choose a DAG over an undirected network. Okay, and that's it for this video. Then the next two videos are more applied, where we're going to look at the software that you can use to estimate DAGs.